Think of all the added sugar we consume in our daily diets, which is not making us feel any more full, just adding empty calories to our meals, but we keep wanting more because we are addicted. Hello, my friends, and welcome back to my channel. If you're new here, welcome. My name is Soukaina. I am a biomedical engineer living in Paris. And in today's video, we're going to talk about sugar, about candy, about chocolate, about pie, cookies, juice, everything we like. I'm sure you have already heard that sugar is bad for you and that you should stop eating it. But then how bad is it? Is it something to have now and then, or is it something to completely avoid? In today's video, I'll try to answer these questions, plus what really happens to our body when we consume sugar, what are its impacts on our health and life, and is there something we can do to better utilize and process the sugar we consume? But first of all, let's start by defining what is sugar. The first type is natural sugar that naturally exists in all foods that contain carbohydrates, such as fruits, vegetables, grains, and dairy. And here, of course, I'm not talking about processed foods, which means that this is the natural state of the food, the way it has been cultivated from the field. These foods also contain fiber, essential minerals, antioxidants, and some plant-based protein. When you consume whole foods that naturally contain sugar, your body digests it slowly, so it gives a steady supply of energy to your cells. Plus, research have shown that a high consumption of fruits and vegetables reduces the risk of chronic diseases like diabetes and heart disease. So you probably understand by now that this is the good type of sugar. So green flag, green light, go, keep consuming it. The second type of sugar, and this is the one we'll be focusing on in this video, is the sugar from processed carbohydrates like pasta or bread, or added sugar that manufacturers add to a product to enhance flavor or extend shelf life. In the American diets, the common sources of this type of sugar include soft drinks, cakes, cookies, cereals, yogurts, candy, and some processed carbohydrates like bread, pasta, or pizza. But you might also find sugar in many items that are not seen as sweet, like soups, cured meat, or ketchup. Well, as a result, we end up consuming way too much sugar than what we might think. According to the National Institute of Cancer, on average, an adult man consumes 24 teaspoons of sugar per day. That's equivalent to 384 calories. And that's just the average, which means some people consume way more. Now that you are clear about what type of sugar we're talking about, let's try to understand what really happens to our body when we eat sugar. When we eat sugar, it is first broken down in the mouth via the saliva, then it travels through the digestive tract where it is absorbed in the bloodstream as glucose. This will raise your blood sugar level, causing your pancreas to release insulin. Insulin is the hormone that tells your cells to absorb glucose and also helps maintain a steady sugar level in your blood. The extra sugar is stored in your liver or your muscle tissue until you need it, and if there is way too much, it is converted to fat. Now, when you consume the second type of sugar, which is artificial added sugar or processed carbohydrates, it is absorbed into your blood very quickly, which causes a spike in insulin levels that can become problematic over time. So how much is too much sugar? Well, that depends on many factors, such as weight, age, metabolism, physical activity, etc. But I managed to find a recommendation by the Dietary Guidelines for Americans, which suggests that to prevent chronic conditions caused by sugar consumption, no added sugars for children younger than 2 and less than 50 grams or 10% daily calories for adults eating 2,000 calories per day. Of course, if you eat less than 2,000 calories, the amount of sugar you can have should be lower. So just to put 50 grams in perspective, a 16-ounce glass of apple juice contains 48 grams of sugar. And a phage honey split cup yogurts contain 25 grams of sugar. Please know that 50 grams is the maximum amount of sugar you can consume. It's not a recommendation that you consume that much. The rule here is to avoid added sugar as much as you can, because it has no nutritional value, plus it increases the risk of many chronic diseases, especially if you are predisposed genetically to such disease. Now let's dive into the impacts and risks of consuming too much sugar. Eating too much sugar regularly can impact our life in so many ways. It affects our thinking, our energy, our stress levels, plus it increases the risk for so many diseases. So here are some side effects to sugar consumption that you might want to consider. Number one, brain function. Many studies have shown that too much added sugars changes how your brain functions, and it has been linked to cognitive decline and many degenerative disorders such as Alzheimer's and dementia. It also leads to a range of memory and cognitive impairments regardless of your age. Scientists suggest that this might be due to the inflammatory effects of sugar on the central nervous system and the hippocampus. Hippocampus is the region in the brain that controls certain types of memory, among other things like the response to hunger cues. Number 2, insulin resistance. As I explained before, refined carbs and added sugar causes a quick rise in glucose in your blood. When this happens very often, it puts an extra stress on your pancreas to produce a lot of insulin, which over time can lead to insulin resistance. Insulin resistance is a condition where cells in the muscle, fat, and liver don't respond to insulin as they should, which means they can't efficiently take up glucose from your blood and store it. This pushes the pancreas to produce more and more insulin to maintain a steady blood sugar level. But if the cell becomes too resistant, this can lead to type 2 diabetes, or in some cases to other conditions such as metabolic syndrome, PCOS, or cardiovascular diseases. Number 3 is skin aging faster. Consuming too much added sugar can shut down collagen repair. Collagen is protein that keeps your skin look plump, so the lack of it leads to thinner skin and skin aging. Research have shown that a diet high in sugar and refined carbohydrates result in reduced skin elasticity, poor wound healing, and premature wrinkles. And that's due to a process called glycation, which put simply means a cross-linking of the collagen fibers, which make it rigid, meaning it loses its ability to make the skin firm. If you want to indulge your sweet tooth and still protect your skin, try to privilege eating fruits, as they contain antioxidants which prevent premature aging. Number 4, the risk of chronic diseases. Too much added sugar accelerates the oxidation process in our cells, which damage protein, tissue, and organs. That increases the risk of many serious health conditions, such as cancer, diabetes, and heart diseases. In a study published in the Journal of American Medical Associations, researchers studied people for 15 years, found that those who got 17% to 21% of their calories from added sugar have a 38% higher risk of having heart disease compared to those who got only 8% of their calories from added sugar. So basically, the higher the intake of added sugar, the higher the risk for heart diseases. Number 5, and the worst for last, is addiction. If I have to pick the worst thing about sugar, it's probably this. You can eat a ton of it and still want more without actually feeling full. I'm sure that if I give you 10 carrots, you won't be able to eat them all. But if I give you 10 cookies, I'm sure you can eat them all in one stand and still want more. Just think of that time you went to a restaurant and instead of ordering water, you ordered soda, and you probably got 2 or 3 refills without ever realizing how much sugar you had. And the problem is the sugar you had from the soda will not make you any more full than if you just had water. So think of all the added sugar we consume in our daily diets, which is not making us feel any more full, just adding empty calories to our meals, but we keep wanting more because we are addicted. When we consume sugar, it activates the sweet receptors in our mouth, which leads to dopamine release in the brain. Dopamine is a neurotransmitter that is released when we are exposed to a rewarding stimulus. And as humans, we are conditioned to repeat the behavior that led to dopamine release. And that's what makes us want more sugar and more carbs. And that when it becomes dangerous because it's something we can't control. Experiments on animals and humans have shown how profoundly sugar activates this reward pathways. It actually surpasses cocaine in terms of the reward it triggers. And that's why quitting sugar is very, very difficult. Many studies on animals have shown that the effect of sugar addiction, cravings, withdrawal, and relapse are similar to those of drugs. Please check the description box for all the links to the research mentioned in this video. Now that you understand the side effects of sugar, I think we can agree that it's something to avoid and something to have very, very moderately. But let's see if there is anything we can do to better utilize and process the sugar we consume. Moderate to intense physical activity makes your muscles shift their source of energy from burning fats to burning carbs. As someone becomes more athletic and exercises regularly, their ability to store glycogen in their muscles increases. Studies have shown that sedentary people have 20 to 30% less stored glycogen than active ones. So in theory, if you are more active, you can get away with eating more carbs. Not just because you're burning more, but also because you can store more in your muscles before it starts getting converted to fat. Exercise also helps reverse insulin resistance because it increases the muscle sensitivity to insulin, especially after exercise, which, as we said earlier, decreases with insulin resistance. Another cool thing about exercising is that your working muscles don't really need insulin to utilize the glucose like a resting muscle. So if you are in the middle of a session and you just eat a simple carb or simple sugar, your muscle will be able to utilize it without the need for insulin. Obviously, exercising has so many benefits, not only on your physical health, but on your mental health as well. So it's a good recommendation in general. Hopefully this video helps you understand why and how sugar is bad for you. I hope it's not too long. Of course, if I have to choose between the two extremes, I'll have to go with avoiding sugar and refined carbs altogether and only getting sugar and carbs from whole foods. But none of us live in extremes. Plus, restriction is not always a good thing. So my recommendation is to make sure to have the majority of your carbs intake from whole foods and have a balanced ratio between protein, carbs, and fats. Don't exceed the 10% recommendation of your calories from sugar, and of course, maintain a regular physical activity. If you follow these recommendations, I'm sure you're going to be fine if you indulge now and then in your favorite sugary treat. Best time to do so is after a balanced meal when your insulin is already high, or after an intense exercise session where your muscle can use that sugar to replenish the glycogen stores. It's also a good time to add protein, but I think you already know that. If you made it so far, thank you so much for watching. I hope this video was helpful. Please let me know in the comments below. Like this video if you like it. Subscribe to my channel for more videos every week. And I'll see you very soon in the next one. Bye-bye.